spirit is rising, she's rising, she's rising. The spirit is rising, it's rising, it's rising. The spirit is rising, they're rising, they're rising. The spirit is rising, they're rising.
Hello, listeners.
Hello, Coven.
Hello, friends. Hello, Amy.
Hi, Risa. How are you doing today? What's getting you through?
Oh, man. This fucking week. Okay, I have stories. I got scoops and stories, okay?
Ooh.
Okay, I'll start with this one. This week I went on like a solo research writing adventure. This is like, I mean, lifelong dream come true. Like one, to be able to drive anywhere, first of all. I got my license at like 40. To be able to have the like means and resources and time to allow myself in my brain to like take a night off and go and like make an appointment with an archivist and like go into the basement of and into these archives and work with these beautiful, brilliant women archivists and for an afternoon, and then like spend rainy afternoons in graveyards and feel so just kind of led by the wind on those days, which I'll tell you guys, frame it in that way for you guys. But often when I drive, I have needed to listen to this same playlist. Like I add things to it, but it has very much been like my emotional support playlist for driving, you know, driving these mountain roads, icy mountain roads, bad weather. But also I'm just like, I never really drove. So everything is new, and being able to sing along to something really like anchors me back in my body and helps me keep my anxiety from overtaking my brain. And it helps me stay like really in the present. Somehow being distracted helps me stay in the present. Please write it and tell me if your brain works like that also. So normally I listen to this exact same playlist because I know all the words to all the songs, but I had this experience following these ghosts in these cemeteries and really feeling like unleashed somehow. Like I was like blowing in the wind. I was also like writing and thinking about lichen, and especially the kinds of lichen like witch's hair or old man's beard that really do travel. They are untethered. They blow and find new places. So I had just left this cemetery where I had found what I'd been looking for. And I'll tell you guys that story another time. But I'm weepy, I'm emotional, it's pouring rain. I'm gonna map myself to this river I want to see. So I'm throwing myself into the arms of the AI, you know, like just take Siri, just like tell me when to turn and I'll turn. Like I don't want to, you know, I'm going to be on these strange mountain roads, and she and I drive really well together. I just trust her and we go weird places together. And I'm like, I'm going to trust the AI musically as well. So I started with a song and we're on the road. And at one point I was just, I had been taken on such a ride by Siri. I'm in these roads that must have been cut. They felt like they were cut hours before. And they're just like the dirtest of dirt roads. There was no reason to take me on this shortcut away from a small, quiet highway. But here I am. I'm on like a logging road. It's all new development. It all feels really strange and wet and snowy. And the road is so scuddy. And I'm bumping up and down in the car. And then on the radio comes this song. I've only heard it on, you know, generated playlists before. I didn't really know this song. And it came on and it just felt, I don't know, it felt important to me this week. And I've listened to it a bunch of times since. It's called No Reason. It's by Toth. And the sort of central, so the guy who makes it, he's like, comes out of a relationship of like 15 years, is like, has a broken leg or something. Like he's just so He's homebound. He's a professional trumpet player. He makes this like layered, and it sounds like what I like. It's like a guy face to face with loneliness and a desire for magic in the world, alone in his room, layering his own voice. Like that sounds like multiple people I've brought to this podcast before. But the core piece, the core verse for me is.
The sun rising exactly in every season.
I want to be happy for no reason, like the sun rising exactly in every season. You've been here before. You've opened the door. You walked straight on through. There's nothing to do, and nothing is wrong if nothing is right. We're happy now. And yes, we practice magic.
Yay.
Yay, you know, it's like I was laughing in the rain on this dirt road, just feeling very held and feeling very, very like I have been so heartbroken and full of rage at the constant brutality enacted towards Palestinian citizens and children. I'm sure you have too, all of you listening, and it is such a complicated place in the world, but there's nothing complicated about saying that children are sacred, you know, and that you can't claim safety while using like laser scopes to amputee children. Like that's just so deeply wrong and so infuriating. And every time I forget for a second that it's happening, I feel more rage and guilt and shame and write more senators and just feel so useless. And then I read this quote this week, and this is another theorist I was introduced to by Christopher Marmolejo, whose episode will come out this week. So you'll hear our interview with them talking about tarot and de-colonial divinatory practice. What a beautiful writer and thinker. And the book is so rich with indigenous and queer and theorists from the global majority. It's such a research project to read this book because I go down every possible rabbit hole of learning about the people that Christopher quotes. And I read this quote from Jose Esteban Munoz about utopia, about queer utopia. And they wrote, "The here and now is a prison house." And that alone just hits me so hard, you know? The here and now is a prison house. We must strive in the face of the here and now's totalizing rendering of reality to think and feel a then and there. Some will say that all we have are the pleasures of this moment, but we must never settle for that minimal transport. We must dream and enact new and better pleasures, other ways of being in the world, and ultimately new worlds. And I feel that in, you know, white guys alone realizing that they want to just step through the door and be happy like the sun, and that they too want to practice magic. I want to welcome everyone together into imagining better ways of being and whole new worlds. So that's my first bit, the prescription.
You said first bit.
Okay, here's second bit. Should I go right in? I
Yeah.
have two bits. The second bit, okay, so this is also about like the comfort song. And so first I have to say, I have to ask you, I don't know if you have this thing, Amy, that happens. I know a lot of people do, but a lot of people don't. Do you have a thing that happens in your brain where you replay like something that you said like months or years or decades before and you like scream cringe to yourself?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh my, I still think about things that I said or did when I was like 8,
Yeah.
9 years old.
And
And
just like your whole face flushes and you just want to like, yeah.
I do want to say that someone said something to me that was so useful that was like, if you're cringing at something you did in the past, that means that you've evolved. And so like, I don't begrudge myself my cringing at my past, because that means like now I know better. Now
Right.
I know better than to say something like that or do something like that. So that's very comforting to me.
Yeah, I'll take that. This one is like a funny one because it also, I think, I'm pretty comfortable with the cheesiness of my taste now in my relationship with you.
I don't believe in cheesy. I don't believe in
I know.
corny.
What's that
I
about
think
you?
if you love it, then like it's wonderful,
Right.
period.
When I first started hanging out with Amy, I was very intimidated to talk about music because, there are two professional musicians in the house. The house is lined with records, and there's such a like a life and a dedication to understanding music and to knowing it. So, but from the beginning, like Amy has been very consistent in her like, there's no like you should have known this. It's always I'm excited if you get to discover something. I'm always excited to discover something new. Tell me about what you like it, So that's
I
good, but
just want to interrupt real quick because this ties to like that cringe factor, of like when I was younger, if someone was like, "Oh, have you heard of da da da?" I'd be like, "Oh yeah," and I would lie because I didn't want to seem like uncool or whatever. But really, what I was doing was like robbing myself of this person telling me about this thing that I didn't know about. So I lost that bad
Totally.
habit when I was like 15 years old. I realized that it was not
Oh, I
helping
think I
me.
held on to that for so much longer. It was like a castle of isolation I built in myself of like, I know it. I got it. Don't worry, I got all the pieces. To the point of like, and I would do the opposite. I still do the opposite. If someone asks me about something and I do know it, now I'm often like, nope, because I can't remember enough about it to speak to it intelligently. So I do the opposite too, where I'm like, ah, don't know anything about that. Might have written my thesis on it, but I got nothing. Duh, no follow-up questions. I got nothing. Anyway, I have been like periodically like cringing and giggling since this episode you and I did a while back of the RX, where I was talking about a Florence and the Machine song, Daffodil, which is a great song. And at some point to the end of talking about it, I said, and then it got so hard. It goes so hard. And I laughed afterwards, being like, my context for like a song going very hard is has been like so limited for so long because I get like migraines and I lose my vision and stuff if certain like with like mathematical kinds of music or really hard kinds of music. So there, I just forget that like my bandwidth is so narrow and is so like really my bandwidth is like sad people singing softly alone in their room. It's like the majority of what my brain likes. And so for me to get into a song that's like Florence and the Machine level heavy, and then I got off that call and was like, the kinds of music that Amy and Andy listen to, like she must have been like heavy, like if she listened to that.
Yeah, I brought like a post-hardcore band for the
Yeah,
RX
listen
this week too.
today.
So, like today. So yeah, Risa and I don't talk about what songs we're bringing, but there always seems to be connective tissue for
Yeah.
sure.
So this week, I've also like aside from getting to have this creative escapism, I also have like a bunch of doctor's appointments, like a CT scan and a mammogram, and I think everything's fine, but I gotta go get everything checked out and have also been dealing with the fear that maybe not everything is fine. And so I drove myself to what I thought was an MRI, which is also it's great when you think you're going to an MRI and it turns out it's a CT scan. That's like 2 hours versus 5 minutes. That's a really nice surprise to have tricked myself into by not listening well. But I was driving myself to what I thought was an MRI and my family wasn't back yet. So I had to go solo. It's like half hour, mountain roads to get to this appointment. And the only thing I could handle listening to, just like level out, I'm back in my like 90s Indigo Girls stage. And all of what I just said was context to be able to bring up the Indigo Girls with all the love in my heart.
So much love for the Indigo
I
Girls. So
love
much
them
love.
so much, especially 90s Indigo Girls. Yeah, so I had that album on repeat for a little while. And I recommend 90s Indigo Girls for anybody. But also I recommend like if there was an album that you listened to in the spring when you were a teenager that like symbolized like your teenage hope and rebelliousness and your sense that things could change and your sense that everything was opening and the smell of spring and the sense of like everything is possible. The world is so much more than what I knew. That is what this album is for me. But please, this week, listen to whatever that album is for you and like hold that tender version of yourself. The song I want to bring is The Wood Song.
Chapter of the book, and then maybe steer us clear from some of the pain it took to get us where we are this far. This far.
And I just want to read the last little piece of the lyrics. So Emily Saliers writes, "Sometimes I ask to sneak a closer look. Skip to the final chapter of the book, and then maybe steer us clear from some of the pain it took to get us where we are this far. But the question drowns in its futility, and even I have got to laugh at me. No one gets to miss the storm of what will be, just holding on for the ride. And the wood is tired, and the wood is old, and we'll make it fine if the weather holds. But if the weather holds, we'll have missed the point. And that's where I need to go." And it connects me back to my optimism again, but also to knowing like, I gotta go through it. We just gotta, can't skip it. We gotta go through to get to that other side, that imagined other world together.
That definitely brings me to my prescription and my feeling this week. The wood is tired, and so am I. I am so tired this week, and I don't know if it's daylight savings time or the Ides of March that I need to beware, or, my brain chemicals or my thyroid in revolution. I don't know. I do have a doctor's appointment coming up, so I don't think my doctor can cure the Ides of March or an existential malaise that's brought about by real world events and not just, my brain concocting things. But the wood is tired, as the Indigo Girl said. And so I brought two songs, both called I'm So Tired. It's okay. It's okay. Some of the greatest bands in the world have felt this way, and I'm going to prove it right now. The first one that I brought is The Beatles. I'm so tired.
I give you everything I've got for a little piece of mine.
And the outro of the song, the kind of hook of the song for me, the best part of the song for me is at the end they repeat, I'd give you everything I've got for a little peace of mind. I'd give you everything I've got for a little peace of mind. That's where I'm at right now. I'd give you everything I've got for a little peace of mind. So if you've got some peace of mind, like I would love for you to share it with me because I'm so tired. And y'all know about the Beatles, so I don't need to get into that any further. The second one that I brought is a song called I'm So Tired by Fugazi. Now, Fugazi is this post-hardcore band that I'm talking about. They came out of Washington and they were kind of, Ian MacKaye was their leader. He was also in a band called Minor Threat. And they were sort of the social conscience of a punk movement. They kept their ticket prices at $5 for as long as they possibly could without, not being able to eat when they were on tour. They made so many of their shows all ages because, like Risa said, children are sacred, and they didn't think that young teens who were, just figuring out who they were should be extricated or prevented from entering that scene, even though it meant that they wouldn't make as much money because they couldn't serve alcohol. They were adamantly against slam dancing, and so they would tell people in the crowd, like, we don't do that here. They thought of slam dancing as like an act of violence, which, it is. It's sort of controlled, getting that aggression out. But Fugazi didn't see it that way. They just saw it as an act of violence. So they were like, we're not doing this at our shows. Everett True was like a music journalist, and he said that Ian MacKaye and Fugazi, quote, had a mindset that believed that any involvement with the system was corrupting and that you should create completely alternative structures outside of that system. So the lyrics for I'm So Tired in part go like this. I'm so tired. Sheep are counting me. No more struggle, no more energy, no more patient. And you can write that down. It's all too crazy. And I'm not sticking around. So when Ian MacKaye sings this, and if you've never heard of Fugazi and you listen to this song, it doesn't sound like a Fugazi song. It's like croony and piano-y. And if you're like, oh, I love this, I'll probably like Fugazi. Check out their whole catalog because
Beware
again,
your
this is,
brains.
yeah, they were like a post-punk, a post-hardcore band. And you know, when MacKaye sings like, it's all too crazy and I'm not sticking around, he's not talking about dropping out completely. He's talking about like, if you don't like the scene, then build your own scene. And what happened with Fugazi was that they sort of drew all these people who had similar ideas as they did. They were so much about that DIY, not just the aesthetic, but the real principle of DIY. Like, much like Risa and I, we everything that's Missing Witches is the two of us. And our membership still has a $1 or $10 a year you can join because we don't believe that your money should be an obstacle to your magic. And this is sort of the punk rock version of that, Fugazi, you know, like.
Also, just to shout out, we're able to do that because we also have a tier that's like $10 where people don't really get anything more. They just pay more because they can. That allows us to keep a $1 tier. Like, and when Amy says we make everything. We do all the editing, we do all the research, we do all the writing. This is we maintain the website. This is like a two-woman show, and we are completely like suspended. Supported and sustained by a community of people who believe in that same thing, like believe in like the kindness of making something new that's safe. So especially with love to folks at the community supporter tier. If you've ever thought I could join those people, or if you I haven't been able to join, just know there's a $1 tier that is supported by people in the community. It's a scholarship tier. You don't have to justify anything. You don't have to tell us anything. Come join the coven at whatever place feels right for you. End of plug of love.
A plug of love and also a plug for Fugazi, who again created a scene that was in line with their values, even though the scene was not necessarily the scene that they came up in was not necessarily in line with those values. And then the people came. The people whose values were in line with that came. And again, you know, all ages shows were so important for them. And Risa, you said earlier there are other ways of being in the world. And Fugazi is kind of, you know, like a punk, emblematically punk rock of that for me. They didn't have merch because, again, they were trying to keep their overhead low. They were trying to keep their costs low. Okay, if we make t-shirts, then we have to bring someone to sell the t-shirts. And then, you know, we have to pay that person. We have to. So we're just not doing it. You know, that kind of thing where, like, again, these, like, this.
That sounds familiar also.
So again, like I just want to say, like, if you're so tired, some of the greatest minds in music have felt that way too. You know, John Lennon and Paul McCartney and Ian MacKaye of Fugazi have also been tired. And maybe you're thinking, I'll give you everything I've got for a little peace of mind. Or maybe you're just not tired enough where you have a little bit of energy to create a new world that doesn't make you feel tired. And that's that garden that Fugazi grew and were so influential there. If you look at people who talked about Fugazi being like one of their favorite bands, or one of the most, you'll find like the people from The Clash and people from the Ramones, and this rippling effect that Fugazi had by sticking to their ethics and demanding to create a scene that was nonviolent, non-capitalist, non-sexist. It was a big deal for them, for like quote unquote girls to be able to be involved in the scene, and they saw slam dancing as a barricade for that, you know? And so they said, we're not having that in our shows. And you can do that too. You can put on a show, metaphorically or literally, where you make the rules. And that's, even though I'm so tired, and again, fuck daylight savings time, can't we just be in rhythm with the earth? Like, madam. Even if you're so tired, there is like this space where you can figure out other ways of being in the world that don't make you feel so tired.
I want to add one other example of like being heartbroken and tired and throwing your pennies forward to reinvent the world. Adrian Lenker from Big Thief, which is a band that I think I brought to the first or second episode of these prescriptions. Their song Simulation Swarm is one of my like deep, like it's on the car list. It's one of the like deep like a dance it out like I'm in a like a trance, like and I'm seeing through the simulation swarm with Adrian Lenker. I love her. She released an album on Bandcamp this week, so outside of any kind of label work, it's the songs recorded as she wrote them. So you hear her breathing, you hear her fingers moving. It's the very first recording of brand new songs that will probably end up on other things and elsewhere, but she's selling it as part of her work to raise money for a ceasefire. It's only available on her Bandcamp, which I will link to in the RX, but the album is called I Won't Let Go of Your Hand, and 100% of the proceeds she's donating to the Palestine Children's Relief Fund. I know she's been so heartbroken, as we all have. She's been really vocal about it. And so to take the like intimacy of the first pass of your songs and make them public as a way of asking people to join you in your heartbreak and to send that money to kids. It's just one more way of doing it, believing in a future.
Give you everything I've got for a little peace of mind. I'll give all the proceeds of this album for a little peace of mind, right?
And blessed fucking be.
And bless the fucking bee. If you want to support the Missing Witches Project, join the Coven. Find out how at missingwitches.com.